Hello and welcome to another episode of the Leadership Lens, where we speak with global leaders, picking their brains on burning questions around business, media, and marketing strategies that are going to be super important in 2021. Today, we have with us Vinay Singh, who is the founding partner at Fireside Ventures, which is the hottest name in the direct-to-consumer startup segment. Anchored by a slew of marquee investors, Fireside manages a $150 million corpus, which is to be invested in exciting consumer brand startups. Some of the biggest names that they support include Mama Earth, Yoga Bar, Bombay Shaving Company, Boat Lifestyle, and many more. Vinay has over 7 years of experience at Hindustan Unilever, McKinsey, and Bank Bazaar across sales and marketing segments. He has a unique perspective on the intersection between consumer brands and technology, and is also an entrepreneur as founder and CEO of Stepney.com, which was acquired by Quikr. Welcome, Vinay. Great to have you on the Leadership Lens.
Thank you, Shaini, and thanks for that very warm welcome.
So, Vinay, let's start with Fireside Ventures. How did Fireside Ventures start? How did you come to be involved with Fireside Ventures?
So I had met my partner Kaval way back, maybe about 8 to 9 years back, when I was thinking about my entrepreneurial stint and how do I think about it. He's been an investor for about 20 years plus in the Indian startup ecosystem. So obviously lots of learnings. And when I exited Stepney after my acquisition, I was thinking about next steps, and it was, like you said, the intersection of consumer and technology that excites me. I spent some time on the consumer side with Unilever, with technology, with Bank Bazaar, Stepney, etc. And I was thinking about how do I marry the two, and how do we think about the new normal of building brands? And in the old school way of building brands, the two big entry barriers were distribution. You had to go store by store, mom and pop store distribution in India, which allows access of your products to consumers. And then there's obviously awareness and proposition building through participation in mass media like print, TV, radio, which requires gobs of capital. All that was changing because e-commerce enabled brands to be available to millions of consumers at the click of a button. And you didn't need to spend the kind of time, money, and capital resources for distribution creation because availability was a given. And even awareness and proposition development could be done through social media, through all the digital media that is available, through micro segmentation and PPC, on almost build it as you go along with the sales rather than have upfront big capital investments and then think about it. And that fundamentally changed the rules of the game for brands. And I was thinking about how we can marry the two, obviously toying with certain ideas in the operating side. And then Kaval and me got talking, and Kaval had already quit his previous VC fund called Helion. He was running his family office, investing in early stage consumer brands. And he said, hey, this could be an interesting broad thesis, which could impact various consumption classes, each having various supply chains, different market constructs, and therefore looks more like a fund thesis than an operating company thesis. And the rest is history. That's where we started Fireside.
Fantastic. Some of my favorite brands are funded by you. So yes. So Vinay, like you said, you know, e-commerce is changing the game totally. We have direct to consumer, which is a buzzword. It's the most preferred marketing strategy, I would say, today. And you've been on the forefront of the space through venture capital, through mentorship, through thought leadership. Tell me, according to you, what are the categories that do really well in this kind of a business strategy?
I think any consumption class that you see, right, is getting disrupted by this new way of, or what we internally call brands 2.0. Whether it is apparel, lifestyle, whether it is beauty, personal care, whether it is food and beverage, packaged food and beverages, even fresh food through cloud kitchen infrastructure. So any and every category of consumption is getting disrupted. And therefore, I think the question really for brands when they are thinking of, you know, with market to access, is always consumer backwards. You have to think about, hey, who is this connected consumer who's currently underserved? In which category? So, for example, if you look at the internet landscape of India, you've got about 500 to 550 million, depending on which report you read, of internet users, out of which maybe there are about 150 million e-commerce buyers. And then there are about 40 to 50 million regular e-commerce buyers who almost live off the internet. They would do multiple transactions on the internet every day. And then which subsegment of that do you really want to go after? Who's underserved in which category? So if it's active lifestyle and somebody seekers of that, living and breathing online, part of that 40 million cohort or 50 million cohort, but currently are not being served well by, let's say, a Decathlon or a Nike or an Adidas. And if there's a gap there, that's something you think about. It could be consumers of personal audio devices like Boat. There are enough brands like JBL and Sony and Philips and Sennheiser and Bose on either side. But there was a segment of this connected audience that was being underserved. They didn't have the right product at the right price point. And therefore, I think disruption is very widespread. Sure, there are some categories that is it becomes challenging for them to be e-commerceable. But I would say that's a minority. I think most of the categories of consumption around you that you think of, something for your kitchen, something for your home, something for your kids, something for your parents, something for yourself, it's getting disrupted. And more the the awareness creation and the transaction, everything is getting fulfilled online.
E-commerceable, I like that adjective. So what do you think are the challenges that are associated? While I agree that almost every brand is, you know, can become a D2C, have a D2C strategy, what are some of the typical challenges that, you know, some of your brands face, for example?
Interesting question, Shani. So essentially, if you look at it, the entrepreneurial team or the core team that's going after a certain market, a certain opportunity, they understand the consumer really well. They understand the needs of the consumer really well. They understand how do you serve them really well with products. They understand the R&D of product innovation. They understand the NPD or new product development. They understand the supply chain. They also understand the emotive or the functional needs of the consumer, and then align their brand promise, their product promise, their pricing in line with all of that. So that we actually don't get very involved with, and actually take a step back to let the founder or the founding team or the core management team of these startups run that agenda. But there are some common pain points that most brands would have. So for example, I've got a segment that is underserved. I've got a product that I think works with them. I've got some good feedback on this product. I know the products that need to be developed. I know the supply chain that needs to come in. But you know what? I don't know the technology stack that I need to build on for my D2C channel, let's say. Now, one might argue that, hey, there is Shopify, there's Magento, there's WooCommerce, there are a bunch of these players out there. And apologies, I'm not taking some names, but that is the easy question. The difficult question is, okay, which payment gateway do I use? Do I use Razorpay? Do I use PayU? Do I use CitrusPay? Do I use Simple? Which delivery API should I use? Should it be MamaShip? Should it be ShipRocket? Should it be delivery? Should I go through an aggregator? Should I go through a direct contact with a delivery logistics player? Which should be the marketing automation toolkit I use? WebEngage, MoEngage, Clever. There's so many choices that the entrepreneur has to grapple with all of this. Now, some of the entrepreneurs obviously are very technologically savvy, are able to evaluate, understand, and take the right calls. Many of them, while they understand their consumer and supply chain, struggle with the technology stack. Some might get the technology stack, but then struggle with, you know, building out the core acquisition funnels, saying, how do I define the events? How do I define bottom of funnel, middle of funnel, top of funnel? Some might get that, but then really not understand. See, it's easy to list on a platform like an Amazon or a Flipkart. But I think for brands, that's where the problems start. The listing part is the easy part. But how do you get discovered when you've got millions of products on a platform? the whole job or the whole victory is about discovery. And it's a goal by 1,000 passes. You need to get your landing page content right, your images right, your videos right. You need to get your tagging right. You need to replicate your inventory in the right locations. You need to ensure that, you know, you've got enough payment options for the customer. You know, you've got the right pricing, the right offers, the right promotion, the right on platform marketing inventory needs to be put in place in the right sequence. I think go to market on marketplaces, D2C technology stack, D2C customer acquisition funnels, financial engineering, saying, hey, how much of equity should I dilute to take care of, organizational building burn or marketing or branding burn? And should I even be diluting equity for working capital, for inventory or receivables? Or can I do that through debt? So these are some of the common questions. And if there's debt, listen, a bank won't talk to me because I don't have a profitability record. Are there alternate sources of debt? Is there venture debt? Is there NBFC? Is there family office mezzanine debt? Is there a revenue-based financing options available to me? Within those, which is the right approach? How do I structure that? I think these are common questions that you've been seeing and hearing across the table. And then obviously, building kind of capabilities at Fireside to help entrepreneurs address these common questions. That's in a sense the nuts and bolts of what we say is the Fireside platform.
Wow, I call it giving legs to a dream. Entrepreneurship isn't easy. Anyways, what started off as a business strategy for most brands like a Mamaearth or a Boat Lifestyle is now, you know, looking like a marketing strategy for our traditional brands. So be it a Nestle, be it a L'Oreal, be it any of them, they are also looking at D2C as a strategy. What are some of the pitfalls that you've seen they encounter? What are things that they should be doing or should not be doing according to you?
I am in no position to give any kind of advice to Nestle's or the Unilever's of the world. I think they have taught us marketing. They have taught us what is a brand and what is the value of a brand and how do capital markets appreciate the value of brand creation. So, in fact, I have been a student at one of these universities, if I might call it so. So, absolutely no advice to give there. I think we still plenty to learn from them. I mean, just recently, the way Unilever is moving in terms of inclusivity and actually building that part of the brand narrative is quite fascinating. But there are some challenges, right? So, for example, having been on the other side in Unilever, I was running the coffee category at one point of time, and we wanted to kind of launch a niche, very top of the line coffee variant. And almost try and premiumize the category and premiumize the brand with that launch. And some of the struggles or challenges that happen then is when an organization is built to catering to Pareto SKUs and handling large volume, where the internal narrative in the organization is full truckloads, making sure that distribution happens, making sure that, stock is moving in large quantities, production is happening in large quantities, economies of scale are coming in. Can that organization have a culture of the long tail as well? Now in D2C, it's about centralizing all of that inventory. It's by saying, hey, I don't want to invest money in working capital in distributing my inventory in 1 million stores. I will keep all of that inventory in a central location and then supplied to customers all across the country. And that means that I have the ability to run the same business, which in a traditional distribution manner could be run only profitably with 5 SKUs. I can now run it with 500 SKUs and still run it profitably because I've centralized all the inventory, conserved the cash and deployed that back into customer acquisition, cross-sell, resell, and really creating communities and audiences and stuff like that. And that's a big cultural shift in mindset. So I mean, this is, if you look at some of the Amazon presentations from way back in the late 90s, this is what even Jeff Bezos was talking about, where your top 20% SKUs that contribute to 50% of sales in a market, not specific to a brand, let's say in a biscuit market, that will always be taken by the big boys, and because distribution, working capital, mass media, all of that is required. And the critical mass that they get out of each of those SKUs is good enough for a good profitable business. But those smaller niches of very specific needs can never be met through mass advertising or through a mass way of building a brand. It requires a more mass customization. So for example, Shiny, if you have hair that is curly, when you walk into a store, you maybe have a shampoo for curly hair. But if you have curly hair, but you also use hair color, you have a shampoo for curly hair, you have a shampoo for hair color protect, but you don't have shampoo that is hair color protect for curly hair. Or if you have curly hair and unfortunately you have dandruff, you have a dandruff anti-dandruff shampoo and you have a curly hair shampoo, but you don't have one that caters to both. Now, those are the underserved niches that mass distribution will never solve, because even if you mass distribute it, at a per outlet level, there's no critical mass because there'll be only one or two takers for that. But if you centralize all of that inventory, there's enough critical mass at a national level to be able to create a sizable business. So those are a business of mass versus business of niche in terms of the cultural framework in which some of the larger organizations think actually gives the space for startups to be formed. So it's not a right or wrong answer. It's just the context in which they do business.
Absolutely. Reaching that critical mass and creating that market for that critical mass. Amazing. And the way you've been doing it and the way some of these brands are doing it is really exciting. So as a startup entrepreneur, if today I have a great idea for, you know, a need that is not being met, and I have an idea for a product as well, tell me some of the things that I should not be doing with that idea.
Not be doing with that idea. Don't sit on it.
So I'll tell you the idea after this.
Yeah. So definitely, I would say act on it. I mean, an idea is only worth so much because I think ideas are aplenty. I think a lot of the success, and not only in a brand or a D2C startup, but I guess in any startup, is about execution. 80-90% is perspiration or 10-20% inspiration, as somebody said. So yes, if you equate that. So definitely not sit on it is something you would not do. I mean, what I can
but
say
is what are the first steps? What should, you know, if there is an idea, what is the first step? Is the first step to come and talk to a Fireside Ventures? Is the first step to do something
else? Oh, absolutely not. You don't build businesses for investors. We are the last people who understand businesses. I think the entrepreneur is the first person who understands that there is a market opportunity. We come much later. We are we also have a fiduciary responsibility of managing risk for our investors.
Okay.
So we would like to know some of those risk points and question it and be skeptical. Because an entrepreneur can actually be more inward leaning and take that leap of faith, take that risk. And that's what entrepreneurs do. So my sense is you build businesses for the consumer at the end of the day. And if you have an idea, the first step is to validate it. Go and talk to 100, 200 customers or potential, you know, target segment or bullseye target consumers and say, hey, this is what I'm thinking. What do you think? Will you buy this? How much will you pay for it? What do you want in terms of product features? What kind of sensorials would you like in this? Should it be this woody flavored or musk flavored? Or if it's a food product, do you want more sweeter or more savory or more, you know, sour flavors? There's so many things about that idea that next level clarity, you start making it real. Saying, hey, is this a problem, first of all? Is it a problem in my head or is it a problem in your head? How many people I spoke to had this problem? Within that problem, if this is the proposed solution, what are the features they like? What are the features they have to think more about, they don't like? What are they willing to pay for this? So that's concept testing. And then actually go out there, get a prototype in place, figure out who your potential suppliers are going to be, manufacturers are going to be, where is the raw material going to come from, how is it that you are going to differentiate from the current products in the market, and then come up with a prototype and then get feedback on the prototype. Say, hey, this is it, why don't you use and tell me what it is. Do some blind testing. Saying, hey, you are used to consuming product A, this is product B, both labels have been removed, use both products and give me feedback. Try and win on those. Do branded testing, saying, okay, on blind test, my product is better, but when I put the brand on top of it, because the incumbent brand has so much more trust, the consumer still feels that that is better. So what else can I do with my product to overcome that hump? And then actually get into market. I'm saying there's nothing as validating for anybody is when you put something in the market, there are paying customers, they're coming back and repeating with you, they are giving you high NPS scores, they're actively recommending it to their friends and family, so there's some virality, there's some organic growth. I think nothing has those metrics. I think then you have initial sense that, oh, my idea has some kind of product market fit, and now if I put more capital behind this, I can really scale it up. And then I think institutional investors start getting interested.
Fantastic. I think those are the first few pages of the playbook that is really required for all of us sitting on an idea thinking, ye chalega, nahi chalega. I think that's what we need to do. Thank you, Vinay. So what I gathered from this conversation so far, and all the questions that we one thing that you mentioned is what the entrepreneur has is in-depth knowledge of the consumer, which is the key to the D2C strategy overall. How big is the dependence on first party data? And why I ask this question is there is so much controversy around data, from your cookie-less browsers to your privacy policies to everything. How big is this dependence on first party data? And because first party data is also limiting at a certain point, how do people kind of scale it? What would you advise?
It's an interesting question. And my sense is, Shiny, the more things change, the more they stay the same, right? So I would go back to Brands 1.0 and talk a little bit about it, and then come back to Brands 2.0 and the specific question that you ask, if you could allow that. In the offline world, the way brands got built, let's say you had the distribution, so availability was not a problem. And then you had some product differentiation, so you've already done that work. So there's a differentiated product in the market. And now you're advertising your brand. And you're advertising it through, let's say, newspapers, through TV, etc. Let's say it's a brand like Axe Deodorant. Now, I put up a front page newspaper ad. Almost 50% of the population is anyway irrelevant to you because, Axe is a male-oriented brand. So 50% of the readers, anyway, you have wasted your media. And then amongst those balanced 50%, some of them are, above 45 years of age, where your proposition doesn't appeal to them. It's all about, use Axe and, get the girl. So these 40, 45 year old guys really don't understand and don't care. So the actual, utilized media there was hardly 30%. And that's when media planners came in saying, how can we optimize that? How can we look at channels? How can we look at various TV channels? How can we look at various media channels where unduplicated reach within the TG you're looking for is maximized at the lowest cost, right? Now, how did that happen? It happened through maybe not first party data, but sample data. You had TRPs back then. Now you had Bark. It's a little controversial today, but there was some measurement tool to help you make those decisions. So that was on the media side. Now on the proposition side, you had a certain brand communication that you were doing on TV, on print, try to make it as consistent as possible, point of sale, etc. And then every quarter you run a brand track and you say, how is my awareness moving? How are my key parameters against various drivers of category purchase moving? And then recalibrate your message based on these inputs to launch your next campaign, to figure out what you want to tweak in the message, etc. Now, all this again was based on survey data. Both your media planning and your creative planning. Now, let's fast forward to brands 2.0. It's the same thing. You need targeting and media delivery through Google, Facebook ads, Instagram ads, Twitter, third-party ad networks, email. You have affiliates, so whole bunch of channels available to you. And then you have your creative, which is measured through CTR, conversion, etc. The point is, the difference between brands 1.0 and 2.0 is in 2.0, you get absolute data up until now. And now questions are being raised on privacy and saying that, hey, you will not have access to some of this data. Fair. So if 30%, 40% of the data available to you is not available to you 2 years later, you can still build brands, because in brands 1.0, you are getting access to only 5% data. You're still better off by 60%, right? So you still have your campaign data. You still have your, for example, website browsing behavior data. Maybe you won't have a way of retargeting it. You'll find another way of doing it. You still have your transaction data. How you can use it might be restricted, saying, hey, the transaction data is only for transaction information. You cannot use for remarketing. Fair, that could be one of the offshoots of all of this privacy concern going forward. But can you not use it for analysis internally and say, hey, people who came from this campaign, I've recorded all of that data through UTM parameters. They've had a certain browsing behavior and then end up buying something. Can I create micro segments and figure out there is a value seeking audience within my overall transaction pool. So for value seeking audience, this kind of ads work. Now it's not absolute. You're still getting to use it only on 60% of the data. That's fine. You can still go out and create a campaign saying 20% of my transactors are value seekers. So for 20% of the spends that I do on top of funnel, I will have a value seeking communication. Or let's say 15% of my audience base is looking for science-based scientific claims, because that's the ad copy they came from, that's the landing page that they converted from, and those are the products that they bought. Now, in today's first-party data world, where a lot of it is available, you might just use that as a similar audience, use that as a remarketing cookie pool, etc. Some of that might go away, but what stops you from creating a top-of-funnel ad saying, hey, these are the kind of people I want to target. And I want to target them with this kind of communication, because I have some evidence in my transaction data that this works. So while it will not be 100% where it is today, directionally it tells you where to go, and you're much better off than where you were before. I'm saying the controversy around this first party data actually impeding businesses might not play out to the extent our worst fears might not come true. I think life will go on. And I think everybody will find a way to exist in the new normal. And I think ultimately we, as responsible businesses, especially in the consumer brand businesses, have to respect the consumer's choices. And if there's an overwhelming support from consumers to say, hey, I would rather not have hyper-personalization. I would rather not have hyper-customization. But I'd rather have privacy. I think we should respect that mandate and then conduct business in a manner that is agreeable with our community.
Yeah, I think what Wanamaker said then is that 50% of my advertising, I don't know where it goes, still holds true. No matter how much data we have, we can never have enough. And life will go on. No need to worry about that. Brands will survive and life will go on. Great. So, Vinay, another thing on the D2C front is that, especially in 2020 and even beyond that, because D2C being so heavy on e-commerce, what we've seen is that it's a sales first, brand building later kind of strategy that they follow. There's a huge partiality towards ROAS, that is return on ad spend, towards lower funnel metrics. What are your thoughts there? Is that the right way to go?
One of the most chicken and egg kind of questions which we are faced with on a regular basis. So thank you for asking that. I don't have a straightforward answer, Shiny. I think we are still discovering the answer to that question as we speak. But at least I can share some of the experiences that we've had. So honestly speaking, Shiny, yes, initially you need to validate your thesis of saying at the very early stage of a startup's evolution, that there are a set of customers who are willing to buy this product for a certain price and buy into the whole brand promise. And the brand has to command some kind of premium as compared to commodity. Otherwise, where are you going to have the money in your P&L to really build your brand? And ultimately, brands, if you ask an economist to define what brands are, they will say it is the irrational premium that consumers pay for commodities, right? So the brand has to have a business model like that. Now, and therefore building awareness, building proposition is implicit in the business of building brands. Having said that, in the early stages of brand building, you first want to figure out, are people willing to pay for the promise you're making? And therefore ROAS, sales metrics become important. Think of it again in the offline world, right? Let's say the internet didn't exist. I was an entrepreneur. I did all my consumer research. I talked to people, did all of that, and created a new biscuit brand with apple flavor because that doesn't exist and there's a market for it, right? What would I do? I would go to stores and place it in various stores. Then I'd do some mass media and see what happens. Now, every time the store owner sells a 20 rupee pack of biscuits, he's going to make 20-25% as retailer margin. So my net retained margin on that sale is going to be only 15 rupees, or not in retained margin. It is the net revenue I make. And then the COGS, etc., I remove that and make a retained margin, right? Now in this new world, online world of doing business, that 15, 20, 25% that we were paying to the retailer, we are paying to Google and Facebook now. I think of it as retailer margin. It is online sales, it's not marketing. You're not really building a brand. Any bottom of funnel activity you do doesn't build brand. It just activates sales. But it's important in the early stages of a brand's evolution that you focus, because if there is a market out there, if there's an underserved consumer out there, there will be some in-market audiences. And our first port of call should be going out and talking to those in-market audiences through our communication and saying, hey, do you like what you see? Are you willing to click on this? Are you willing to give me a good CTR? Are you willing to give me a great CPC? Are you willing to, you know, give me a good conversion rate and overall buy my product? And if you don't have a very large bottom of funnel or in-market audience for that product, maybe you need to rework on your product itself. But once a basic critical mass of that happens and you're validated, saying, hey, at a reasonable cost, I'm able to reach out to customers. There are enough customers out there willing to buy my product. There is some unit economics that is kind of starting to emerge. And I'm not saying it needs to be positive. I'm saying even if you make a loss on sale, but 30-40% of the people come back and repeat with you, and they are repeating at a cost of 1/8 the new customer acquisition cost over 2 transactions, you're still making money. So I'm saying any way that you can validate to yourself as an entrepreneur, saying, hey, there is money to be made here because there is an underserved audience that is liking the whole product or the whole package, the experience. Then you can say, hey, now why don't I widen this and let me start building top of funnel. Let me start creating awareness. Let me start creating some kind of brand pull, some kind of proposition development. And then that also opens up the audiences as a D2C channel that I can tap into for retargeting, if not remarketing. And actually pull them into the funnel through middle funnel creators, bottom funnel, and then the full funnel kind of starts to emerge. But it's very important initially to be a little frugal. And especially if you have not raised money, especially if you have not, raised any kind of external capital, to validate for yourself, because you are putting as an entrepreneur your hard-earned money into your business. So it is your fiduciary responsibility to your family that you be a little careful and thoughtful about how you go about spending that money. So validate, scale up is my point of view, and I might be wrong. I mean, there might be businesses that will get formed tomorrow that actually upfront spend a lot on top of funnel, awareness creation, and then still build a very large and profitable business, and I'll be proven wrong. But at least if I were an entrepreneur on the other side, building a brand, I would first, lean in on it, test and scale as an approach.
No, absolutely. Very, very practical approach, Vinay. I appreciate that. I think no matter what you do, whether you're a large brand or a small brand, whatever, it's important to build those foundations and get that some amount of rock solidness there before you go all out into the market. And, on similar lines, we saw a lot of consumer support for D2C brands, especially because of e-commerce going through the roof in 2020. And I think a lot of e-commerce brands did very well in 2020. It was a fantastic year for a lot of them. Even your e-commerce, like your Amazons and Flipkarts of the world, of course. Where do you see this? Do you see this consumer behavior really changing post the COVID? Once we've all got our vaccine shots, are we going to go running to the supermarket once again, or will the sum of it really stick with us?
I wish I had a crystal ball, Shiny, to answer such questions. I think all of us will discover how things go back to the normal. But I'll take a leaf out of some of the consumer psychology research that has happened and maybe try and build a mental model to at least analyze how we can think about the future. So let's say that you want to pick up running as a hobby or astronomy as a hobby. All consumer psychology material points to a 21-day time frame, saying if you want to pick up a new habit, you want to give up sugar in your chai, you want to stop desserts, or you want to eat more of vegetarian food, anything you want to change about yourself, if you can stick to it for 21 days, you probably have a 3x chance of adopting that as a long-term habit than if you do not do it for 21 days. Now, we've been through a tough year last year, right? Lockdowns, a lot of people went through salary cuts, job losses. Obviously, the health aspect of a lot of our people suffering because of COVID, etc. It's been a tough year. And in this year, there's been a change in human behavior where suddenly consumers were wary of going to the store to buy products because it was just from a social distancing angle, not the right way of, at least there's fear of doing that. And therefore, a lot of consumers for the first time have bought categories online that they never have bought online. So you would still, for example, go and buy an iPhone or a OnePlus or a Redmi online because you get all the selection, cheapest cost. But for your vegetables, you would still go to the neighborhood store. Or for your groceries, you would still go to the neighborhood store. You would, for example, buy, let's say, your clothes online from Myntra. But to buy personal care, you would still go to Health and Glow. You would, buy, let's say, some household furniture item online at Urban Ladder, Pepperfry, but still go to a restaurant to eat out. So consumers were living in an omni-channel world where based on whoever saw value where, both in terms of pricing, convenience, selection, whatever the value was, bought something online and something offline. In many cases, it was combined as well. You wanted to buy a cycle for your kid, you do your research online, then go in the store, test it out and then buy it. Or you test it out in the store. Let's say you want to buy a TV. You go to the Croma store, test out the TV and then go and buy it online. because you save 10%, right? So there are all sorts of behavior that consumers were exhibiting. A lot of the offline behavior was forced online because there was a certain pandemic. And forced not for 1 day or 2 days, but for 9 months. And going back to my 21-day theory, when somebody has been doing something for 9 months, some of it, my senses will stick. Now, for example, somebody who never bought groceries online was forced to buy groceries online from Grofers, from Big Basket, from Amazon Prime, Amazon Now, etc. And suddenly that's become a way of life. Saying every week I put in an order, I get good vegetables, I get good products, I get it at a good time, I get it at a good price. I have no complaints with it. So even when everybody gets the jab, why would I waste my time going to a grocery store? I'd rather use it to listen to music or see a Netflix or play with my kids or spend time with my friends or my family or whatever it is. Right? I never used to buy clothes online because size fit, I had problems. Now I was forced, I bought it, works for me. Now why would I go to the store? No, I'd rather go to a multiplex when I get the jab and watch a movie, or I'd rather go to a restaurant and have a meal. So I think some of this behavior will be sticky just because of the time duration under which this behavior was almost a default behavior for a lot of consumers. Some of it will go back shiny because there are people, retail therapy is a real thing, right? There are people who like to go to a mall, browse with their friends, take opinions, try out 3-4 things, then buy something. It's something delightful for them. And on the other hand, there are people who hate shopping. But I'm saying, so there will be some of it that will be sticky. There will be some of it that I think will go back. Because obviously, after sitting at home for so long, there is a whole cohort of people who are like, yeah, I'm done with Corona. I want to step out. I want to meet people. At the beginning of the Corona cycle, lots of people were very happy with this work from home, saying I get more time with my family, it's more efficient, I get more done in a day. The same people 9 months later are like, yeah, I'm done with that. I'd rather be slightly inefficient because I don't think I can keep running like a 100-meter dash as a marathon. I can't do this forever. Good for us. So I'm guessing different categories will come back differently. Offline will still be important. I don't think offline is going away in a hurry. But the way this offline will happen will change. A lot, my sense is that a lot more discovery will happen online. Offline might be used for experience and final transaction would be online. Or online will be used for discovery and final transaction will be offline. Offline will still be very important, but how much of it will still stick, how much of it will go away, which category, I need a crystal ball for that.
Can I ask you another future gazing question? So when you say everything is going to kind of coexist, each of these categories have their own space in our life, I understand retail therapy is super important. We will probably go back to a mall, but for the therapy part of it and not really because it's a need anymore. What do you see the future of retail then looking like? What will the future of retail look like then? If it's going to be more about therapy and not really a requirement, I can obviously buy a dress online, but I'm just going there for the experience.
Like I said, Shiny, I think retail, while it's going through a tough time right now, give it another 2-3 years, we'll come back and come back strongly. I think every time any industry has been challenged, the players in that industry who have innovated have come back even stronger. And we've seen that across industries, whether it's real estate, whether it's automotive, whether it is FMCG, whether it is even brick and mortar. I think like I gave you an example that there'll be people who will go back for retail therapy, I'm saying that now how much of it will happen in which category is a question. right? The way the business is done on retail will also be different. So for example, omni-channel will start to matter a lot more, where there's one inventory, it's available wherever you want it. You want it on the site, it's the same thing. You want it on a marketplace that you're comfortable transacting, it's the same thing. You want it in the retail store, it's the same thing. You can go try it out in the store and we will go back to our omni-channel inventory and deliver it back to your house. So it's almost like retail will have to adapt to this omni-channel approach where you are available as and when the customer wants you. And then they might choose to do it in 10 different ways. So for example, we have a brand of bicycles called 91 Cycles. So they have a D2C channel. And they have a footprint of about 750 stores across 150 cities in India. Now, pre-pandemic, we still had the website, but we never paid any attention to it. Our whole hypothesis was always that a 15,000 or a 12,000 rupee bicycle, people are not going to buy online. They'll want to touch and feel and, you know, experience it. But with this new normal, we're pleasantly surprised that a significant portion of the business today is driven purely online. And when we are talking to consumers, we are seeing all kinds of behavior. They're saying, hey, we come to your website, we check out various models, we shortlist. Then you have a store locator facility. We locate the store closer to us. We go to the store with a prior appointment so that, you know, we ask them when is a non-rush hour, we'll come. We don't want to be, you know, in part of a crowd. We go and experience the products there. Sometimes we end up buying it there. Sometimes we come back, think about it, which one we like, discuss it with our friends, family, parents, etc., and then end up buying online. So all kinds of behavior is coming. Interestingly, even the retailer's mindset is changing. So earlier, retailers were only interested in doing business with the brand where the representative of the brand, the salesperson, came to the outlet, spent some time with them, then, you know, had a conversation about how business going, what products are moving, what products are not moving. Okay, then I have these recommendations for you, why don't you try it, etc. Today, because they were also forced to be in a lockdown and they also worry about their family's health and their health, they want to socially distance, they don't want to meet, you know, 20 salesmen who are meeting 20 other people every day. They have moved to an online way of working, saying that, hey, please send me these cycles because I'm out of stock, or what new variants do you have? Let me know and I'd like to buy from you. And a lot of that business in this cycle company, like I was telling you about, has moved online. They have launched an app looking at this consumer, this retail behavior. And now around 50% of their online sales actually happens without any salesperson ever visiting anywhere. The retailer is comfortable being on an app. The app is hyper-personalized based on, you know, that retailer's previous sales history. So similar products get popped up into his feed, similar discounts that he has used before or trade schemes that he has been excited by get pushed back to him. So there's hyper-personalization there as well. So the D2C aspect of it, while in the Puritan sense is talking directly to the consumer, this B2B is also getting almost digitized. So, and therefore this enables one inventory, this enables omni-channel. I think retail will be important. It will come back. The players that will innovate will actually reap far larger dividends. And some of it, this online behavior will be sticky. How much of it, time will tell.
So no matter if it's online or offline, idea is to make it seamless for your consumer. And that consumer can be the end consumer, or that consumer can be your retail owner. So either way, the idea is to just make it seamless and as easy as possible to buy the product.
Yeah, so we just differentiate the consumer is the end user and anybody else buying your product is a customer.
Okay.
So whether it's a consumer or a customer, you need to make it easy for them, however they want to do business with you.
Correct. Absolutely. So another thing that I think about, Vinay, is that we have these big aggregators and a lot of, products that you serve are in the FMCG space. This is why I'm asking this question. We have these huge aggregators, your Amazon, your Flipkarts. And then you have, manufacturers who are selling these products on their own websites. So if I'm a brand, I have a website and I'm selling it. And both of them are kind of advertising in the same spaces. And in some cases, advertising the same products in the same spaces, right? Creating competition, kind of, I'm advertising against myself, bidding against myself, my own product. You think this is sustainable, or is there another way to do this?
So is the question shiny aggregators versus D2C? Is that?
Yes. Aggregators versus D2C. So where do I buy my Vadam tea from the Vadam tea website or from Amazon? Because both of them are advertising to me. Where do I go? Is that sustainable?
It's all dependent on what the consumer wants, right? So if you look at more digitally mature markets, let's say the US or Japan, now, let's take US numbers, right? 330 million population, 300 million of them connected, about 270 million of them transacting on e-commerce. Therefore, they are so, it is part of life for them. For 90% of the population, buying online is the way they are. And they've transacted multiple times on platforms such as Amazon, Jet, DoorDash, etc. That it is just so natural to them. And therefore, when a new website comes up and says, hey, come to my website and buy directly from there, the friction is very low. Because they know that, yes, delivery will happen. Yes, there will not be a credit card fraud in most cases, etc. Whereas if you look at the digital maturity of a market like India, we have only 40 to 50 million of those kind of consumers who transact seamlessly across multiple platforms. There's 150 million e-commerce transactors, but a lot of them are just transacting for one or two things in a year on an Amazon or Flipkart. I mean, yeah, sure. 5 years later, these numbers are going to all go up. Those are the projections. Those 150 million shoppers are projected to be closer to 350 million. And therefore that 40, 50 million will also go up, and 600 million or 550 million internet connected media consumers will go up to a billion. So that funnel is just going to become larger and larger. But that's the reality, right? Saying as a non-internet user today, first I have to be comfortable with using the internet. And I'm the first thing, if I get connected today, I'm not going to start spending money on the internet. First, I'll get some information, some media, some entertainment from it. Then I'm going to say, hey, oh, I can also buy stuff. So let me buy something. And then I will buy stuff. And that buying typically will happen with an aggregator first, the marketplace first, because they have the brand, they have the trust, they're able to deliver the product in 2 or 3 days. They have all the capabilities to make it easier. And then once I've done multiple of those transactions, then I'll be happy to say, hey, let me go to another website and then buy something also, because I trust the internet. So I think it's all about a digital maturity curve of individual markets, right? So my sense is, from an India perspective, on digital, you need to be present wherever the customer is. So if you're a beauty brand, sure, you'll have a website. But if you're not present in Nykaa, there's so many beauty customers there that your brand will never show up with them, no matter how hard you push Instagram and Facebook on your own website. Because Nykaa is also competing for the same audiences on Facebook, Instagram. Nykaa is also competing on the same keywords on Google. And therefore, they have a much larger audience pool of vetted beauty audiences. So fish where the fish are, right? Make it easy for the customer to buy. So you have to be available across all of those. And yes, you can still have a D2C brand. So for your core set of users or your power users, you can give them some level of customization, some level of personalization that deepens the relationship between the customer and the brand. I mean, so for example, while I might buy certain products of let's say Mamath from a Nykaa or a Amazon. If I'm a regular user of Mamath, and if Mamath is able to come and tell me, hey, you have been buying some, you know, face cream or lotion from us, but by using the cleanser, which is the face wash, and a night serum, you can expect such results along with the cream that you're already using. Now that's value adding for me as a consumer, because now suddenly you are talking regimen and you are talking benefit. You're not saying that just buy my cream because I need to earn money. You're saying, let me solve your problem. You have a problem of dark circles. This is how it's going to be solved. Let me, for example, a brand like Yoga Bar, if I can buy the muesli and the bars on a big basket, but if it can come and tell me that, hey, this is the kind of muesli that's right for you in the morning, and this is the trail mix you have in the evening, because I can help you achieve your target of, let's say, lowering your BMI, then that's helpful, because then you're establishing a relationship with me that's meaningful and outcome driven for me rather than selling product. So I think both the marketplaces and the D2C channel have their own reasons to exist, and brands will need to play these channels according to the requirements of the channel. I mean, I give you examples of consumer backwards. There could be examples of brand forward as well. So for example, your D2C channel could be almost like your digital lab. You have a captive set of audiences. You have a new product that you want to launch. Show it to them, get live feedback. You have two packaging options for the new product, A/B test it. You have three pricing options for the new product. You know, A/B test it, look at the conversion rates. You have, two formulations of the core product itself. Again, A/B test it and look at, you know, repeat cohort data to see, you know, which one is better liked than consumers. And then take those mixes and then scale them up through marketplaces. So I think each channel has their strengths and weaknesses, and brands that recognize, you know, what is the role of each channel in my route to market strategy, and then building, you know, plans or business plans that are, you know, fit for that channel's advantages. I think they'll be able to leverage that network effect much better, and actually create a brand experience for the consumer that is meaningful.
Absolutely. I think there is so much more that a brand can do with the consumer, especially in an era where the consumer does not mind being a co-creator.
Absolutely.
Doesn't mind, you know, sharing feedback and is open to all kinds of conversations with a brand and wants the brand to actually take them seriously. I think
absolutely. See, brands 1.0 was one-to-many communication. The brand gave some TV ad, brand gave some print ad, and that's it. Then 3 months later, there was some feedback that got collected. Here, the moment you communicate, consumers will talk back. They will comment, they will share, they will like, they will diss, they will love, they will do all of that and be very vocal with how they felt about it.
Yeah.
And as you rightly said, they want to be recognized as part of the brand journey. So it's a many-to-many kind of collaboration between the brand and various members of the brand. So the brand manager, the NPD R&D person also talks to consumers. The supply chain guys talk to consumers about delivery and delivery experience, packaging. The packaging guys talk to consumers. The finance guys talk to consumers in the new brand, saying pricing and so on and so forth. So it's a many-to-many co-created relation way of building brands. So for example, we have a brand called Gynoveda, which is solving the women's menstrual health problem. And they have a community called the Circle of Sisterhood, which is essentially all women coming together and talking about some of these taboo topics that somehow they can't talk at their own home. They, for example, if they're married, they are feeling shy to talk to their mother-in-law about it. Sometimes they even feel shy to talk to their own moms about it. But in this online community, there is a little bit of an anonymity. You can talk, you can be more open. And we find that to be a very, very vibrant community where actually the brand participates, not so much in terms of communicating the brand message, but saying, hey, we are coming out with this new product range. What do you guys think? What do you want with it? What kind of flavors do you prefer? What kind of packaging do you like? We've got these two options. What do you say? You've got a beta product or a prototype. Would some of you want to test it out and give us feedback? And we'd like points of improvement. And that creates almost like this very bonded community where when a new member comes and says, hey, I've tried the product, it doesn't seem to be working, the brand doesn't even need to intervene because the community members itself come in and say, hey, we know what you're talking about. You just started taking it 3 days ago. Give it a week and you start seeing results. And the brand doesn't even need to get into that conversation because the community is coming around the brand and saying, hey, what we help build, we will also help protect. We have a board of moms with Mama Earth, similarly. We have a boat heads community around boat, which you spoke about.
Yes.
So, and all of these are examples of the same.
Building your champions, building your consumers as your own champions and co-creators. What more do you want as a brand? So another thing, Vinay, is that, like you said, you know, consumer gives them feedback. Consumer, you know, talks back to the brand and it's many to many. And an important platform on which this happens other than your own e-commerce website is your social media channels. Do you see this as a challenge of any sort, you know, so much content on social media about brands?
Yeah, challenges. See, there are always challenges, Shiny, but there are always fixes for the challenges as well. Obviously, there's so much of chatter going around. It's humanly impossible to, cater to each conversation because just the size of the communities are becoming so much larger. But then again, technology plays a role. You have listening tools, you have ORM tools. You can take advantage of a lot of these technology solutions to kind of streamline some of the workflows internally in the organization. So the pros just so far outweigh the cons that I wouldn't even acknowledge it as a challenge because if brands do not actively nurture communities, in this new connected digital world, I think the relevance will go down further and further. So brands should find a way to nurture communities, be more active, be more proactive, actually lean in to this new way of working and then find a way to make it more efficient internally rather than say, hey, in the interest of, organizational resource management, let me forego some of this, then you're actually losing out a large portion of real value add to your brand.
Absolutely. I think more and more, you know, the brand and the product is so much more than the brand and the product. It is actually consumer, front, center, left, right, everywhere, I think. And the idea of community building and social media playing such an important role there, I think. While there are challenges, it's not something we can overlook or not do at this point in time.
Consumer is the queen.
And the king and the janta and everything.
Absolutely.
Great. So as new age brands, you know, as brands who are still kind of finding their footing within this, when they approach new partners or when they're approaching new media channels, trying to figure out marketing strategies, what is your advice to them? How, like you said, you know, first you did give us a playbook and said, first test it out and talk to people, start with an ROAS strategy. Yes, first start with ROAS, make some money before you go brand building. So what are some of these important considerations they need to keep in mind when approaching new partners, especially media channels?
Yeah, I mean, after a certain critical mass or validation of your product market fit as a startup, as a brand, I think obviously channel diversification is a very, very important part of the overall media strategy. And saying, hey, how can I, just like I'm physically available wherever the consumer wants me, whether it's a marketplace, whether it's D2C, or whether it's an Instagram store, I'm available however the consumer wants to transact with me, or shoppable ads on YouTube. Similarly, from a media or mindshare perspective, awareness perspective, I want to be wherever the consumer is. And therefore, once you've initially figured out who your customer is, who your TG is, who's the core audience you're going after, and now you know you want to build that strategy further, channel diversification is super important. I think brands will need to understand what channel plays what role as part of the funnel. Not every channel is a top of funnel channel. And not every channel is a good middle of funnel channel. And not every channel is a good bottom of funnel channel. So you need to play that piano and say, hey, can I use, let's say, video, whether it's on YouTube or Facebook or Instagram stories or whatever, to really build awareness? Can I retarget them with maybe carousel ads or GDN or search ads to actually figure out their intent? Where they are they a cold audience? Are they a warm audience? Are they a hot audience? And then accordingly nurture them through affiliates, through you know, co-branded partners, through let's say, you know, direct media buying or programmatic, depending on what scale you're at, to actually kind of see how I can get them interested in buying the product, and then re-engage with them through both remarketing as well as your own proprietary channels like email, push notifications, SMS, Facebook Messenger, etc.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Vinay. I think our conversation today, you've really, you know, put out the playbook for brands on what they can do initial days, middle days, you know, large scale brand building days. Thank you so much. It was a fantastic conversation. And thank you so much for sharing these insights with us.
Thank you for having me over, Shiny. Really appreciated all the questions. And obviously, as we have more conversations, it pushes our thinking. I'm taking back a couple of, you know, thoughts back from this conversation saying, hey, maybe we need to think deeper. We need to have very, very insightful questions. Thank you so much for that. And hope some of the conversations add some value to the community that you serve.
Thank you.
Bye.